Saurabh, and you're listening to my favorite talk show, The Weekly Show with Aditya.
This is episode 232 on the 10th of July 2020. Tonight's episode, as usual, will be divided into three parts. Part 1 is a song rendering. Part 2 is reading from the book P.G. Woodhouse. And part 3 is continuation of the discussion of the England-West Indies tournament. Let's start this episode with part 1, that is rendering of a song. Singing of a song. Which song will it be? It will be revealed to you in just a couple of seconds.
तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, जाना है तो माना नहीं, मुझे पहचाना नहीं, दुनिया दीवानी मेरी, मेरे पीछे पीछे भागी, किस में है यहाँ दम, तेरे जो मेरे आगे आना नहीं, देखो टकराना नहीं, किसी से भी हारे नहीं हम, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें। तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, जाना है तो माना नहीं, मुझे पहचाना नहीं, दुनिया दीवानी मेरी, मेरे पीछे पीछे भागी, इसमें है यहाँ दम, ठहरे जो मेरे आगे आना नहीं, देखो टकराना नहीं, किसी से भी हारे नहीं हम, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें। तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, आते जाते राहों में कब कैसे गुल खिलाएं, जो उलझे वो समझें हम क्या कमाल कर जाएं, फूलों की राहों से कांटों को हटा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें। अरे तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, आग लगा दे पानी में, पत्थर पे फूल खिलाएं, बिन मौसम बिन बादल रिमझिम सावर बरसाएं, हम आग लगा दे पानी में, पत्थर से फूल खिलाएं, बिन मौसम बिन बादल रिमझिम सावर बरसाएं, पूरब के सूरज को पश्चिम से उगा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें। अरे तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, जो हम मन मौजी मस्ती के साज बताएं, जो झूमे ये धरती वो चांद सितारे गाएं, हम नाचे तो यारों को साथ नचा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहें वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें। तूने अभी देखा नहीं, देखा है तो जाना नहीं, जाना है तो माना नहीं, मुझे पहचाना नहीं, दुनिया दीवानी मेरी, मेरे पीछे पीछे भागी, किस में है यहाँ दम, ठहरो जो मेरे आगे आना नहीं, देखो टकराना नहीं, किसी भी हारे नहीं हम, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें, हम वो हैं जो दो और दो पांच बना दें, जो सोचे जो चाहे वो करके दिखा दें।
This ends the rendering of the song. Now, let's move on to part 2. Let's move into the aunt's omnibus and see what our protagonist, Bertram Wooster, is doing. Something always happens to put him off. I think he was about ready to close the deal before he went to stay at Brinkley. But most unfortunately, I bumped into a valuable vase of his and broke it. It seemed to rankle rather. I heaved a sigh. It's always what Jeeves would call most disturbing to hear at a chap with whom you have plucked the Govan's fine, as the expression is, isn't making out as well as could be wished. I was all set to follow this Pinker's career with considerable interest. But the way things were shaping, it began to look as if there wasn't going to be a career to follow. You move in a mysterious way, your wonders to perform, Stinker. I believe you would bump into something if you were crossing the Gobi Desert. I have never been in the Gobi Desert. Well, don't go. It isn't safe. I suppose Stiffy's sore about this. What's the word? Not Vaseline, vacillation. That's it. She chafes, I imagine, at this vacillation on Bess's part and resents him letting. I dare not wait upon. I vote like the poor cat in the adage. Not my own, that, by the way, Jeeves. Pretty steamed up, is she? She is, rather. I don't blame her. Enough to upset any girl. Pop Besse has no right to keep gumming up the course of true love like this. No. He needs a kick in the pants. Yes. If I were Stiffy, I would put a toad in his bed or trichinine in his soup. Yes, and talking of Stiffy, Bertie, he broke off and I eyed him narrowly. There could be no question to my mind that I had been right about that perilous stuff. His bosom was obviously chock full of it. There's something the matter, Stinker? No, there isn't. Why do you say that? Your manner is strange. Remind me of a faithful dog looking up into its proprietor's face as if it were trying to tell him something. Are you trying to tell me something? He swallowed once or twice and his color deepened, which took a bit of doing. For even when his soul is in repose, he always looks like a clerical beetroot. It was as though the collar he buttons at the back was choking him. In a hoarse voice, he said, Bertie, hello, Bertie, still there, man, and hanging on your lips. Bertie, are you busy just now? Not more than usual. You could get away for a day or two. I suppose one might manage it. Then you can come to Tortelet. To stay with you, do you mean? No, to stay at Tortelet Taz. Stared at the man, wide-eyed as the expression is. Had it not been that I knew him to be abstemiousness itself, rarely indulging in anything stronger than a light larger, and not even that during Lent, I should have leapt to the conclusion that there beside me sat a curate who had been having a couple. My eyebrows rose till they nearly disarranged my front hair. Stay where? Stinker, you are not yourself, or you wouldn't be gibbering like this. You can't have forgotten the ordeal I passed through last time I went to Tortelet Taz. I know, but there's something Stiffy wants you to do for her. She wouldn't tell me what it was, but she said it was most important and that you would have to be on the spot to do it. I drew myself up. I was cold and resolute. You are crazy, Stinker. I don't see why you say that. Then let me explain where your whole scheme falls to the ground. To begin with, it is likely that after what has passed between us, Sir Watkin B would issue an invitation to one who has always been to him a pain in the neck to end all pains in the neck. If ever there was a man who was all in favor of me taking the high road while he took the low road, is this the same Besse? His idea of a happy day is one spent with at least 100 miles between him and Bertram. Madeline would invite you if you sent her a wire asking if you could come for a day or two. She never consults Sir Watkin about guests. It's an understood thing that she has anyone she wants to at the house. This I knew to be true, but I ignored the suggestion and proceeded remorselessly. In the second place, I know Stiffy, a charming girl whom, as I was telling Emerald Stoker, I am always prepared to clasp to my bosom. At least I would be if she wasn't engaged to you, but one who is a cross between a ticking bomb and a poltergeist. She lacks that balanced judgment which we like to see in girls. She gets ideas, and if you care to call them bizarre ideas, it will be all right with me. I need scarcely remind you that when I last visited Tortelet Das, she egged you on to pinch Constable Eustace Oates' helmet. The one thing that a curate should shrink from doing if he wishes to rise to the heights in the church. She is, in short, about as loony a young shrimp as ever wore a wind-swept hairdo. What this commission is that she has in mind for me, we cannot say. But going by the form book, I see it as something totally unfit for human consumption. Didn't she even hint at its nature? No, I asked, of course, but she said she would rather keep it under her hat till she saw you. She won't see me. You won't come to Tortelet? Not within 50 miles of the sewage dump. She'll be terribly disappointed. You will administer spiritual solace. That's your job. Tell her these things are sent to try us. She'll probably cry. Nothing better for the nervous system. It does something, I forget what, to the glands. Ask my well-known Harley Street physician. I suppose he saw that my iron front was not to be shaken, for he made no further attempt to sell the idea to me. With a sigh that seemed to come up from the soles of the feet, he rose, said goodbye, knocked over the glass from which I had been refreshing myself, and withdrew. This ends part 2, the reading part of this talk show, and now let's begin part 3. Welcome to part 3 of this episode. I have been watching the England-West Indies match over the past 2 days. And if you remove all the bizarre and the extreme rules that came with the match, the preset conditions that players cannot venture out of their hotels after their training finishes, they should go back to their hotels, they are not allowed to talk with the broadcasters, the commentators, and not allowed to mingle with other officials. If you remove this bizarre and extreme part of the rules of the game, the match was as it was expected to be. Former West Indies player Brian Lara, who for me is not a legend but an average player, said that the match wouldn't last more than 3 days, that West Indies wouldn't survive this. But I think West Indies has shocked everybody by coming up with a performance which would have taken best of the critics' heart in their mouth. Of course, the premise is that England has a weaker team. Why? Because they don't have two of their better batters in Joe Root and Jonny Bairstow. So, the premise is that England went with a weaker squad. Let's include Moeen Ali also in the prominent batters. So no Stuart Broad, no Moeen Ali, no Jonny Bairstow, no Sam Curran, and no Joe Root. Well, Joe Root could not come because of personal reasons, but could they have included Jonny Bairstow, Sam Curran, Stuart Broad, and others? It was a toss-up between Josh Butler and Jonny Bairstow for the wicketkeeper's position. Keeping the boat in the team was always going to be a tough proposition. This match was the match between two of the top all-rounders. On one hand, we have Ben Stokes, the best all-rounder England has ever produced. A more competitive all-rounder, a more talented all-rounder than even the likes of Ian Botham and Andrew Flintoff. On the other hand, there is Jason Holder. Respected, seen as a great all-rounder, even getting the ubiquitous number one ranking all-rounder position. But let me remind you, West Indies never had fast bowling all-rounders. In fact, Jason Holder, in their more than 40 years history of playing this sport, right from the 70s till date, had all-rounders, but the all-rounders were spinning all-rounders. For example, we are still obsessed with a certain Lance Gibbs or a Larry Gomes. This guy, Jason Holder, well, the name doesn't seem so attractive, does it? No, it does not. But being the captain of the team when he was given the captaincy at age 22, 6 years ago, everybody thought, who is this guy? Why is he being given the captaincy? And now, almost 40 matches later, he is the second best fast bowling all-rounder right now. Coming to the premise, England was bowled out for 200 runs. Yes, some will argue that the conditions were tailor-made for swing bowlers because it was overcast all the time. In fact, day one ended with only 17 overs, with Payne playing a major part in disrupting the match. And then when things began to look good on day two, bad light came into play. What is bad light? When it is not raining, but it is so overcast, so dark, that the umpires, who have a light meter and they determine a level, that at this level and beyond this level, the match is deemed dangerous for the batters to view. The ball cannot be viewed by the batters. As I said, if we remove the bizarre and the extreme rules of the containment zones the players and the officials have to be kept in, if we look at the match as a normal match and even forget for a while that the match is played in front of an empty arena, it was as great a match as you could have. Everything was done perfect. Looking at how such matches go, looking at the past and looking at the obvious and the repeatable nature of such matches, the first premise that this match won't go into day 5, well, if rain plays a role, then this match will go into day 5. How many runs will West Indies make? At this point, even if West Indies take a lead of 60 to 70 runs, it will be a huge factor in the match. One will argue that the West Indies team is also relatively weaker. Well, it's not exactly weak, but it's the fact that a lot of players refuse to come on this tour. For me, it's a big deal that they are even organizing the match in the midst of a fearful situation. That the organizers of both the cricket boards have taken a decision that enough is enough. How long can we wait? How long can we wait for till somebody says that it's safe? That word may never come out from the mouths because people are afraid to use the word it's safe. Nobody wants to use these lines. Therefore, in this context, other countries should follow suit and start their domestic version. Means India should also start a few localized matches, see how players who have been kept out of exercise and cooped up in their homes for the past 4 to 5 months, are they rusty? How will they come back? Because a sportsperson is like a digital device. If I don't use my phone for a while, it will rust. Similarly, if a sportsperson doesn't come out in the field, he or she doesn't practice, irrespective of the fact that whether it's a combat sport, whether it's a semi-combat sport, or whether it's a sport which doesn't require too much of close contact. We cannot give excuses by sitting and saying that it's dangerous. Players cannot come together. and all this thing could be spread all around. I think we need to get this out of our heads. If we want to know and ask that combat sport is dangerous, well, let me give you an example. You may not exactly take it in the best of minds, but let me give you an example of things which we are exactly afraid of. When the UFC, which hosts is martial arts matches, which were also stopped, they are also restarting their matches. If you have seen UFC, that is mixed martial arts, there is no bigger close contact than this. They're constantly near each other. Social distancing is practically impossible. In my view, it's top to hide behind such excuses which are no longer excusable, and we should just start. Then there will be the argument, it's fearful, it's not safe. When is anything safe? Everything is unsafe. We are always fearful of the fact that players take some sort of banned substances and now they will be tested for something else. According to me, players are used to testing. Either they are tested for banned substances or they will be tested for this particular thing. In a profession like sports, forget the term physical / social distancing. Forget that there would be a 2 meter. Well, there would not be even a -1 meter distance. It's not possible. It's the way the sport is. If such rules are being enforced strictly, that in sports we are going to begin slowly. Yes, beginning slowly is a different thing, but if you don't begin within 3 to 4 months of resuming practice, then it's a waste. Then the only sport that an individual can play without fear is chess, because for chess you probably don't even have to be face to face. You can do it using a computer. The other game that can be played is Scrabble, which means the International Olympic Association and such allied organization will have to change the definition of what is a game and what is a sport if they are fearful of combat sports or team sports like football, hockey, cricket, basketball, or badminton, tennis, where the players come close or there is interaction with the match officials. Then it's time we allow games like Scrabble, Snakes and Ladder to be played online. Means an individual plays on their computer from their home, competing with another individual who is sitting in their home. Means I can play with anybody. Means the rigidity with which the International Olympic Association works, they have to shed it first. All the Olympic associations of all the countries and the international organization which is in charge of sports world over and Olympics and other such sports as a whole will have to change their mindset. Which means there should be an open chess tournament. Means even if you are an amateur, a professional, or you have never played this game in a professional environment, they should be allowed to play. Forget rankings, forget what you have won, forget your previous records. Just open the tournament to each and every individual on the planet who wants to play. Unless such flexible rules come into play and the Olympic associations of different countries agree and they get their head out of their ego, only then can we say that maybe other sports and the social distancing and the frequent contact and the close contacts can be avoided. But unless we allow other sports to flourish, for which all we need is a digital device, till then, start sports. This is my only analysis of this. This is the only way we can understand this. We have to stop fearing in terms of whether a certain sport can be played or cannot be played just because there is going to be little or no distancing between the officials, the players. Yes, some rules like no interaction with the broadcasters, or if you want the broadcasters to interview the players, you can do it via satellite, saying things like get your own towels and your own water bottles from whom it works. But what if this person is traveling? They cannot afford to have their towels with them all the time. Some kind of middle path has to be played. Some kind of uniformity has to be brought. If you want the whole gamut of and the whole gimmick of social and physical distancing to play out. Otherwise, this entire thing about being concerned about sports restarting or not restarting is nothing more than a charade and a gimmick. Coming back to this West Indies-England match, what is my analysis of it so far? I think I do not agree with the fact that England has a weak team. Yes, they don't have marquee players and legendary players like Johnny Bairstow, Sam Curran, or Muin Ali or Stuart Broad. These four individuals are not there. Instead of them, you have Dom Best, a young spinner. Then you have Ollie Pope, who has replaced Joe Root. Josh Butler has replaced Johnny Bairstow. And Mark Wood has replaced Stuart Broad. England had scored 600 runs, for example, in a hypothetical situation, then one would have said that the pitch is flat, it doesn't help the bowlers. But here it's extreme. England is out for 200. And now you are saying that the team is weak. They cannot adjust to the swinging and the seeming conditions. What are we trying to say? Why this double standard? I'd rather have a low scoring match where each team makes between 200, 250, 300 than have a match where one team bats for 2 days, makes 600, the other team gets 300 twice and the match ends in a draw. I don't want to see a draw. I'd rather have a result. Which team will win in this situation? I don't know. But there will be a result. Rain will play a part. But this is where countries like England and Australia differ from the subcontinent. If it rained for a few hours in India, the match would have been called off. It rained for 3 hours without a break and yet the match was not called off. They waited even though they had only 17-18 overs. They had some match. Had this match been happening here in India or Sri Lanka, or somewhere in the subcontinent, had it rained, let's say the match usually starts around 10 a.m. and had it rained till 12 p.m. they would have called off the match. Despite having the same International Cricket Council as their head and the same rules to be followed. But then such is the nature of this bizarre sport and the individuals who play an active and passive role in it. I was listening to the commentators, the way the commentators speak, especially in England, the commentators are languid, laid back, and their way of speaking is a little dull. Crowd or no crowd, let's say even if a match begins in India, how will and where will the commentators sit? The commentary box is a fire hazard, it's a tinder box. Commentary boxes in India or the commentary rooms is smaller than the smallest pantry we have in the kitchen. Such is the nature of this room. It is a virtual tinderbox. You can't walk out without tripping on the other. I hope during this break, the organizations who are in charge of grounds, they make sure that they refurbish and renovate the commentary boxes so that if they start tomorrow, how will they make sure that whether there are two commentators who are sitting at a greater distance, whether it's one commentator or whether they have some cardboard box between them, a cardboard box cannot fit in those rooms. I hope the organizers of the grounds or the managers of the grounds who are the curators who make sure that the grounds and the stadiums are kept in perfect condition, they have this same thought about the commentary boxes.
दिस एंड्स टुनाइट्स डिस्कशन एंड एपिसोड नंबर 232 ऑन द 10th ऑफ जुलाई 2020. Stay tuned for the next episode.
For more awesome content, tune in to the next episode of The Weekly Show with Aditya.